Okay, Ron, I'm here with Margarita Witch Cult. How you doing, guys?
Lovely, mate.
Good, man.
Lovely. How are
Good.
you?
Yeah, I'm really good, thank you. Thanks for joining me on the show. It's a pleasure to have you. Loving what I've heard so far from the album. Really, really good. Other than hearing the music, though, I know nothing about the band. So if we do a bit of an introduction through this interview, hopefully my listeners will get to know about you guys as well. The only thing I do know is you're from Birmingham and
Yeah.
you're inspired by the usual suspects, Sabbath, Electric Wizard, Pentagram, stuff like that. And you can't pick three better bands to be influenced by, really. Why don't you
It
kick us
gets a
off from
little
there?
bit like it's a bit like memeable how like often that's said, but
Yeah,
can't change
absolutely.
shit, can you?
If it ain't
No,
broke,
no.
try to fix it.
They're on the list for most bands for a reason. That's it. That's what I put it down to. Exactly.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah. Tell us about maybe about the name, because Margarita Witch Cult is not your standard band name. How on earth did you come up with that? I don't normally ask this question, but it's such a cool name. I want to know the story behind it.
Really, it was a mixture of, your witches and your cults and everything, and all of the stuff with like, have a passing slash obsession with, combined with the fact that we really formed during lockdown,
Right.
and when you couldn't see each other and practice perfecting the perfect margarita recipe was like a daily obsession.
it happened quite a lot. It happened. We've been in Zoom calls and just like, drinking with each other, but Scott's margarita home recipe got honed in. And I think, like you mentioned, Pentagram, Electric Wizard, like quite overt occult themes are taken, they're done, they're mastered, that's killer, that's why they're our influences. So somebody's described us as a spooky doom party before, which I thought was cool, because it's kind of got that party element to the occultist and Wiccan and pagan kind of thing. It's always an admiration and by no means a kind of pastiche rip-off, do you know what I mean?
Because the witch cult bit, yeah, fairly standard, but the margarita bit is what brings your personality into it, from what I've heard
For
so
real,
far. I'm saying.
it's a love of margaritas, Motorhead, mezcal. It's just party, party.
Party doom has got a bit of an oxymoron, really, isn't it, somewhere, but it works. It really does
was
work.
the starting point, really, and that's where it went. You don't want to be some bonehead drunk guys, but
Yeah. Knuckle draggers and stuff like that, but you want to bring
what
all
happened happened.
the So you said you formed during lockdown. I take it you guys knew each other before that, though. Otherwise, how did that work?
Well, yeah, I mean, you guys have been friends for way longer than I knew you guys. The band kind of got together. Well, Scott started the project and you had the riffs for a good couple of years before.
Yeah, it just was my other band that I was in before, and still am, still love it, and so slightly different vibe. But we went on tour with Monster Magnet around Europe for a month,
Wow.
and I was just like, already into loads of the bands in the scene, like Graveyard, Uncle Acid, and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
But then just seeing those guys, legends, doing it, in at the age they are, every night with this power, I was just like, I've got to just get these riffs I've got down. I didn't know how it was going to work out, but then it didn't seem like it was even an issue that you had to work out how you're going to get it down, because no one could do anything anyway.
Yeah.
You couldn't play. If we'd have probably like hooked up and started writing the tunes and working them out together and been like, oh wow, let's play a show, when you weren't quite ready after five, six practices, as you can do,
Yeah.
and just having a whale of a time doing that. But we didn't have the option. You have 6 months where you couldn't do anything, and then back on again. And it was just, so we were able to just hone every last detail. So me and George started jamming, and I just met him, year before that or something.
Yeah, roughly.
Okay, wow.
Similar situation. Like I was in another band, still am loving the punk sort of music side of stuff, but Scott had these riffs and knew me through kind of just the Birmingham scene. That's how I met James and how well you guys. Scott had already had James in mind, but lockdown got in the way of bringing James in. And then it was like, oh shit, like definitely the third piece to the puzzle. And yeah, after a few practices, we were kind of like, damn, we've got the album down, the set is down.
He was like just the best guitarist in Brum, so it was like take him out of his comfort zone and try learning the big guitar.
Yeah. Do you know, it's one of those, it's one of those things that I get one of two answers when it comes to lockdown, you know, and the effect it had on bands. There are some bands who it absolutely just stopped everything, got in the way of tours, got in the way of promoting themselves as a new band. And then there's bands like yourselves who actually it stopped them from that temptation of going out and doing shows too early. And like you just said, honing your skills and that, which is, I suppose, a real blessing in some respects, because young bands don't normally get that time, do they?
Yeah. So when we were able to go in, you know, we did some demo stuff whenever it's, I think we actually recorded all the basic tracks just before they announced like another lockdown.
Right.
From just doing it with cassette stuff that we had around the studio to do the demo that we actually ended up putting out. And that took like 6 months to be able to get together to even do the overdubs.
Yeah.
But after that, by the time we were just back together and practicing, when we were able to book a studio thinking, oh yeah, let's do a single, we were like, we just went in, shocked the engineer and just did a whole album in a day.
That's amazing.
A couple of songs aren't the first take. And apart from that, there's one guitar overdub on every track, maybe like one more vocal other than one each, and that's it.
Yeah.
Just 9 songs, 2 days, boom. So we never would have been in a position to be able to do that if we'd have been, you know, playing the dog and duck every Friday night and getting wasted. And, you know,
the isolation helped us realise that, I think.
Yeah, just, and it gives you that time just to focus on that one thing, as you say, doesn't it? The other interesting thing that you just said, which I find a lot when you look back over the history of kind of doom and stoner rock and stuff like that, the crossover with punk and certain band members' relation to other punk bands and the punk scene is really strong throughout this. I mean, you take, you know, Caius, for example, and the Palm Desert scene grew from a punk scene. You know, the Obsessed grew out of a hardcore scene. St. Vitus and that then came from that as well. So it's one thing that doesn't sound like it goes together, but does more often than not. What do you think's behind that?
Attitude, DIY ethic.
Yeah, and keeping it simple as well, you know. You can imagine how bloated like 70s rock was before punk, which is why all the punks like Motorhead.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
You know, like, and then you think about, like, Discharge are playing DesertFest this year.
Yeah, mental, isn't it?
Yeah, it does make sense when you think of it. You just think of all the Sabbath riffs in isolation that you could imagine a punk band playing. Well, I suppose then you get like Nirvana.
Pretty much, yeah. Do you know, there was a band I heard once that used to do Ramones songs in the style of Black Sabbath and Black Sabbath songs in the style of the Ramones. That's the kind of thing that you're talking about.
Sweet. Crowbar's another one. Crowbar's a band that comes from hardcore roots and has utterly destroying riffs. I saw them play in Birmingham a few weeks back. With our good buddies Void Lurker, they fucking shred. It has that massive punk background because it's a DIY approach. You know what I mean? We have luckily had time to utilize, by, you know, how we explain, using the lockdown as much as we could to try and like hone ideas in. It is that DIY ethic. When we knew when we were ready, so it was like now we can show people what we've been doing, sort of thing. That punk crossover, man, it's a strong vibe.
It really is, yeah. I think it's that, you know, that authenticity that comes with it as well. Like you said, you know, not much layering over the album, bang it out, get it on the tape and try and be done with it as much as possible. I mean, there's some bands that obviously take that to a different level and have started layering to great effect as well, don't get me wrong. But I think that's what connects the two scenes, isn't it? Is that like it, what you get down on tape the first time is pretty much what you get.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, agreed.
You got, that's, you talked about this, sorry, say that again.
Just say it's a good way to work. It's a good sort of pressure to put on yourself, but kind of a thing. Pressure makes diamonds. Do you know what I mean? Absolutely. Yeah, but it works.
Obviously, the album's coming out, I think, this month. Is that right? Or are we pretty much in a couple of weeks or so, isn't it, I think?
Yeah, been realizing that today, and that scared the.
It's a week and 2 days, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
21st of April, man.
Yeah. So you say, like, you realize that today, making you a bit nervous. Is that just waiting to see what the reaction is?
I think it's just like planning, like lots of the stuff we've got afterwards. We've got some festivals coming up, and then we're going to Europe and things like that. Spent so long thinking about that actually you're like, oh no, it's actually going to be out there.
Yeah. What we've, the most hard work that we've put in, we kind of not closed the book on it, but getting signed and like having it realized it queued up to come out, it's almost the least of our worries. It's been our longest release date for a while, do you know what I mean? Yeah, that's been like settled and signed for a little while now. So we're like, right, 21st of April, don't have to worry about that.
Not the actual album coming out almost seems like a bit of an afterthought of everything else. Yeah. What happens around it, do you know what I mean? Like, oh, and the album actually comes out on that day.
Yeah, people get to go, oh shit, there's nine tunes, like fucking rad, oh my God, like, yeah, so.
Yeah, we've been in a position where we've had like, you know, back in January, I mean, we put a couple of demo things out, but we'd taken down everything and it was just starting from the first single, the only thing that we had online, didn't even have a video for it. So to know, you know, and the reaction you get just from having a couple of singles up, as we do at the moment, just can't wait for people to actually hear all of the other songs.
Yeah.
You know, lots of people's live favourites that we take for granted because we've been playing them for a year now.
Yeah.
Well, that's always the problem with an album, isn't it? You lay it down, you know, for fans, it's brand new on release day. But for you, you've lived with it for so long by that point. And as you say, that's almost kind of just like the afterthought on the rest of the process, isn't it? You know, with lining everything else up. How do you try and keep that fresh for you when it comes up towards the album release? Because you're going to do, as you say, these festivals and shows. It's going to be new to the audience. You want it to kind of feel fresh to you as well, don't you?
Yeah, it's always just gets harder and harder as well, doesn't it?
Mm. To
no, harder as it's sonically as well.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
tighter and tighter. Yeah.
I mean, we're quite you know, we're fortunate enough to be in you know, a position where, although it's obviously going to be completely new to the audience, it isn't necessarily that old to us either. Really, yeah. It's like, and as Scott's alluded to, you know, even if it's something as like, oh, you know, I've got a new bass amp or something, like little things happen to keep a live experience sort of fresh, whether it's, you know, just a rearranging the set or just playing, you know, we're still honing the sort of live sound really. So being able to play with different equipment and try, we've been on a bit of a mission to make ourselves sound as good as we can in a live environment. So it's sort of been, you know, it hasn't been a repetitive exercise in that sense. It's always been something a bit different, whether it's like working with a new sound guy who I'd be working with a bit more or something like that. There's always something you can do until you reach that point where you're like, right, this is as good as it can be. But that's an ever-moving target, isn't it, really? So
yeah, even though we've played, you know, we played, feels like we played a lot, but we actually haven't. It feels like it's not just the album release, it's our release of us that we're going to start playing, you know, we're playing festivals in London, Bristol, Switzerland, Serbia and places like that. It feels like a band release rather than an album.
That's a huge audience that you're going to get in a short period of time that you wouldn't get just through doing your own gigs, isn't it, in a way? So I can see how that would feel like that, because all of a sudden, album's out, big wider audience, it is going to feel really fresh. And I suppose having something like DesertFest so close to the album release as well must give you that real pumped up feeling for playing that live.
That was such a good email to open. It was a great month, in fact, a great 6 weeks. One of the reasons it's definitely come up in conversation, me and Scott, after a few beers, just, mate, wow, imagine if we got booked for DesertFest in like 2-3 years time. And yeah, I mean, you laugh about it and it's just like, ha ha. It's actually one of the reasons we've fucking made the band a bit more of a, let's get a bass player in, And then this DesertFest offer comes through. So we were stoked for that. And then was it 4 weeks after Heavy Psych Sounds was like, we want to sign you. So and then we had to explain to Heavy Psych that we'd actually got DesertFest before they'd given us any offers. And we were kind of fumbling our words, just going like, wait, this is actually kind of happening. And this is cool. So we just said yes.
Yeah, but someone's like, write down on you spend so long like of just things failing or things, you know, not going your way, and then you like write down all the things that you would ideally want to happen, and then when they happen you just get that imposter syndrome thing happening. You know, like, yeah. No way. A label that we're perfectly suited to actually likes us, and a festival that we'll don't be suited to want to put us on. Nah, that can't.
Yeah,
like, oh, bloody hell, it can. Yeah, you just actually have to spend long, you know, writing the song. You're like, oh, we did. So,
yeah, it's sick. Bloody hell. Let's have it. Have it.
I was going to say, you can't ask for two better, you know, areas to pick you up as well. The people behind DesertFest and the people behind Heavy Psych Sounds really support this scene, have a great reach out, and people trust them as well. So I can just imagine how perfect that must have all been falling into place at the same time.
And I think there is, you know, being a band that sounds like Black Sabbath is one thing, but being a band that sounds like Black Sabbath that's also from Birmingham probably doesn't hurt the scene and something like that. It's like, oh, we've sort of got the genuine article a bit more, you know.
The Black Sabbath at home.
Yeah. Even though, none of us are actually from Birmingham.
But do you know, I was gonna ask the question.
Born in Bromsgrove, man.
You were.
I was born in Bromsgrove. I'm a Brummie.
Yeah.
But I was going to ask that, but I thought, do you know what? I'm going to leave that one because I wondered if that brings a particular type of pressure with it, because, you know, we've got stoner and doom bands in the UK, but I can't recall anyone specifically coming from Birmingham doing doom.
There stuff. Are bands from around here, but I think one of the issues with Birmingham is that there's very little, in terms of rock music anyway, very little of no industry tastemakers based here. So bands often have to look further afield to get signed or relocate, etc. Obviously, in our case, we're fortunate enough that we're signed to a label that's not even on the same, you know, piece of land. So that sort of gives us more scope to tour elsewhere. But no, I think there are bands not too far removed from what we do around Birmingham, but maybe they are just flying under radar because, you know, that there's not really anyone shining a light on them, really.
But did that, when you started first putting stuff out there, did you immediately, like you say, you know, to the labels, it looks like we might have something that's the genuine article here, you know, Birmingham based. Did you get that a lot when you were trying to put the band out there, comparisons or people going, oh, you're going to be another Sabbath, things like that?
Well, I don't think anyone thinks that they could ever be as big or as influential, but as James says about how nice it fits in, it's just the fact that we all ended up living here.
It's not like you're wrong. It isn't like a conceited, like, we didn't all sit down one day and be like, you know what? What if, you know, as we're all from Birmingham, we actually started a metal band, the Sandalites? Do you know what I mean? It wasn't like a planned thing in a sense of like, oh, you know, here's an angle that we could take. It just happens to happens to be, this is the kind of music we play and this is where we live. You know, we could easily be from Northampton. Wouldn't really make too much of a difference.
Yeah.
I've had a lot of people say like, oh yeah, I thought there'd be loads of bands like this in Brum. And you're like, no, there aren't really.
No. Like I say, I was racking my brains trying to think on that. I'm sure there's one that's come across my inbox or something like that, but off the top of my head, I can't think of anyone.
Yeah, that said, there have been a few, I mean, but you know, it's just, I think it's just more difficult to be on the radar of your tastemaking websites as you're from Birmingham, because there's not
everything's got a London bias, hasn't it? There's a London bias to everything. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like there's no real website that's going to turn up to your gig and review it. And all of a sudden, you know, your gig's going to be reviewed in Loudon and War or something. Like, there's just no one really from those sort of publications is in Birmingham reviewing shows in Birmingham. So, you know, you have to sort of go down different avenues to try and get noticed, I suppose, which is, and Birmingham, you know, as well, like, you know, obviously we live here and I'm sure we all have a degree of fondness for it, but it is definitely, I'd say, much as there's a pro-London bias, sometimes it almost feels like there's a bit of an anti-Birmingham bias just because it is, you know, by the rest of the country, kind of considered a bit of a shithole, which may or may not be justified, but there's nothing sexy about saying we're so-and-so from Birmingham. Do you know what I mean? It's just, it's not an opening line to an email that's going to entice anyone into.
But when you say, yeah, but we can say from the home of metal.
Yeah, exactly. Like, so
yeah,
if you listen
yeah.
to every band from, you know, within a 10, 15 mile radius of here, it's like you'd struggle to find, apart from the Bay Area in the mid 80s, you'd struggle to find anywhere else as good.
It's also a relatively recent affinity that it seemingly Birmingham's populace have had with the whole metal thing. I mean, the home of metal, you know, with the Black Sabbath Museum or exhibition.
The 80s, relatively recent.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, we did start this band before the latest season of Stranger Things. I don't want to make that clear. But I don't think any of us have got a problem with the latest season of Stranger Things existing.
Yeah.
But, you know, we came first.
Well, I mean, like, when you say, you know, obviously we're nerds with all that stuff as well. We wouldn't be as obsessed with, you know, Black Sabbath as we are. Who isn't on this scene? It's a thing you don't even need to say nowadays, isn't it?
Yeah.
But you walking around, you know, like our studio in Digbeth, and like you've got all, it's gentrifying like by the day. You know, you've got like film studios moving there and all the rest of it, and cocktail bars and everything. But you still do get the vibe. I mean, like even around here, the jewelry court over in Aston and everywhere, you feel, you're like, those guys in the late 60s were walking around here and playing it. You know, every time you go past somewhere, you're like, there's the block of flats that's in the inside on the back cover of Volume 4, Zeppelin 4. Or you're like, that's where Sabbath played their first gig. Yeah. Or that bit of car park there is where so-and-so lived. And, you know, you feel it around.
Yeah, I get the same. I live just outside of Cambridge, and you get it with Pink Floyd as well. You know, that's where they did that album cover, and that's where they did that. It does give that real buzz, doesn't it?
Yeah.
There's still a sort of murky industrial, you know, edge that Birmingham has to it. And it's sort of a for better or for worse sort of thing, because, you know, whilst, for example, you know, where we rehearse in Digbeth, it is not known as the nicest sort of area in Birmingham, you know, to walk around necessarily. It's getting nicer by the month, but it's also, as a result, you know, a lot of creative spaces that existed there have been knocked down, or, you know, the rent payers have been driven out. So, you know, it's sort of as Scott said, you know, the gentrification of it is both a good thing and a bad thing, really. But there's still enough of the sort of residue of the, you know, 70s industrialist sort of landscape that you can still feel it.
Yeah, when I first took up that studio on where we still rehearse now, you could hear like steel presses and stuff going all the time.
Oh, really? Wow.
You still can, you know, there's like galvanizing happening over the road and the smells and stuff. You know, I mean, you can't imagine what it must have been like when it was.
Well, there's that sign coming into the back of Digbeth where it's BirminghamHeavyMetals.com. And it's just a place that makes metals furnishings, like actual metal work, metal spinning, Birmingham Metals, heavy metal Birmingham. And you're like, shit, this is the industry that actually kind of made the town as historic as it did. Yeah. And why Tony Iommi lost his fingers.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So,
yeah,
man, we're as Birmingham sounding as they come. Musically, not vocally.
Yeah, you're disappointed by that, aren't you? You're like,
I was expecting some thick Brummy accents. I really was.
Yeah, I do try, but it just, when I try and speak clearly, I sound like Carl fucking Pilkington.
Yeah, you don't want that. You don't want that association. Everyone will be laughing too much. after the festival season that you've got coming up in the summer, are you going to get out for an autumn tour to further promote the album, or is that kind of?
Yeah, we're going to look at a UK run later in the year, and then we're back to Europe in October.
Okay.
With some more festivals and stuff. Can't quite remember what's announced and what isn't.
DesertFest Belgium.
DesertFest Belgium
is announced. That's sick. I'm just so excited to do the first run of shows and get the first tours underway and seeing what links we can make. And I haven't really thought as far as autumn or winter, the first year of the album being out is gonna sadly go very fast. So I'm trying to not to think about autumn. Yeah. You know what I mean? I'm trying to think about now. And I'm excited for all of it.
Well, on the European run, then, you talked about the festival run. You mentioned Switzerland. I take it that's Heavy Psych Sound Switzerland that you're going to be playing for that one.
Yeah, we're doing two of those in May.
Yeah. Is there any cities in particular you're looking forward to these festivals? Because obviously we just talked about, you know, the historic Birmingham. You know, there's places like Hamburg, isn't there? Berlin, you know. Are you looking forward to anything like that?
Yeah, man. Amsterdam, Hamburg, Barcelona. Like, just... It were Heavy Psych Sound being from Italy themselves.
Yeah.
That is going to be a sightseeing tour just as much as playing some gigs and the way of life. You know what I mean? And not a favourite for me.
But we going to places like Serbia and Croatia. And just. Can't think of the.
No particular favourite. I think it will just be meeting bands essentially from the Heavy Psych roster that are going to be European and used to doing this, which is going to give us a very good kind of XP points. We've nailed some gigs in Europe that we can bring back to our English shows, and we can, it will be the perception of us from the interior will change. Do you know what I mean? I think we'll feel like a bit more road, like kind of hardened, or a bit more like
absolutely
legitimized by those kind of those foreign country shows where people don't speak English until they say to you like, "Oh, we love your CD." You know how humbling that feels, or how I don't yet. I'm excited for all of this. You know what I mean? I want to, just make people as happy as they have been in England.
Do you know, I've never thought about it that way before, but having someone that doesn't even speak your language as their first language telling you how much they love your album must just be mind-blowing. It really must.
Hopefully, that's what we're waiting to find out. We'll see.
Absolutely.
Your album shitters is mind-blowing. Hopefully we won't.
You don't want that'll send you on the opposite direction.
The thing is with like touring and stuff as well, there's a million, there's more than one way to skin a cat, is there really? Like, we've done a fairly sort of front-ended campaign thus far, I think you could say, but the way that our dates are spread out over the next few months, there is very much the potential that we might be returning to places in a relatively short amount of time. So I think our sort of trajectory as a band will be as much reliant on word of mouth rather than us just releasing like seven more singles from the album or something. Do you know what I mean? And it's sort of that word of mouth that's really kind of got us to the position
in. It's incredible we can get booked in the first place, because it's like, the guys booking our shows and things, and we get these offers for these festivals. Do you want to play on top of a mountain in wherever? You're like, of course we do. Of course we do. You look at me like, this looks amazing. Yeah, we'll come to Austria. But at the moment, if you're pitching a band, you're like, do you want to book them as part of this European tour? And they're like, at that point, you know how far in advance things have to be booked. Mm. It's like, oh, what? These guys with one single out and a few thousand monthly listeners, people are going to be cagey about it. So we kind of are very, very aware that despite it seems like way we've got this far, it literally is just that April 21st day, which is probably why I was like, so oh my god, that's so great.
That would be where it begins
from. It's this literally, even it's like, oh right, we've got a band now, what do we do? So it's very hard to predict, but apart from getting everything booked and hopefully good reaction and being able to book a really cool UK tour and go out and meet shitloads of people, we're also just still down every week working on the next album.
Wow, that, already working on the next one.
Come around quick, yeah. You know, yeah. We've got tight and rehearse for shows, but other than that, it's like you spend 2 years touring this and doing this. You know, we could do this year's festival season, then a UK tour, and then be booking next year's, and then be like, yeah,
new songs. We need new material, man.
We're way over
this second tour coming up in a year or so. We need some new songs for that one.
Do that interview. Get that interview in the bank now about the next album. We're 8 songs into that now. And
oh wow!
So whether or not we can do, maybe we'll do the next one in like 3 days rather than 2.
Luxury,
yeah, that whole extra 24 hours. Guys, on that note, thank you so much for joining me. It's been an absolute pleasure speaking to you, and I can't wait to see you guys at DesertFest as well. I'll be down there for the weekend, so I'll definitely come and check out the set.
Thank you. Yeah, very much, man.
Yeah, come to the Blackheart on Friday in the afternoon.
I'll be there.
Drop us a message and we'll meet you for a beer.
Yeah, thanks. That sounds good. Okay, guys, thanks so much, and see you then.
Love to see
you. Cheers, dude.
Bye-bye.
Bye.